So we're ready. I have been informed that we have a quorum. We're ready to start. Mr. Christopher Lee, our counsel.
1382, Senator Stavisky, which is a legislation to actually reduce from one third to one quarter the amount of income a senior has to spend on rental in order to qualify for SCRE. It will have the net effect of increasing another 7,000 persons within its applicability. It is what Senator Diaz calls common sense legislation. He's asking for a yes vote.
Look up here. Hey, here you go. Mr. Nova.
I like the build up, the opposite is not common sense.
So, all in favor of the bill?
He's well worth his money.
Aye.
All in favor of the bill?
Aye.
No, I'm the negative. I vote.
I don't know.
He has never voted yes.
I have voted yes.
I'm just glad he's not working on
that money. I'm serious. Okay?
Is this
come when he votes against one of his own bills.
No, he voted for an epic Canadian drug bill.
That's right. I was here when he did that.
And he went to the public hearing, and he was a very strong supporter of that.
That's you did that.
Which is another common sense legislation that the Senator wants done.
So we have one no. So it's yes. Next bill?
1602, Senator Blatsky, which is it would amend the real property tax law. Which again, Senator Diaz is asking for a yes vote on this. This is common sense as well. This says, look, if a spouse experiences a sudden a loss in income due to the death of a spouse, they should be able to show that in April when they have to prove what their income is and not rely on documents that are 2 years old. This simply brings reality into line with what is fair and reasonable. So the Senate asked for this.
Interestingly, I have a very similar bill in higher ed for TAP. In other words, if a student's condition changes, same situation.
All in favor?
Aye.
Oh.
Scary.
Oh.
You voted yes?
Yes.
Good villain.
Yes. I missed it.
Yes. All right. We're moving. We're getting somewhere.
2033, Senator Golden amends the elder law, which simply lets the state in on the reality that often when children are placed, grandparents have to be included as legally defined and family
within. I just have a couple of questions.
Senator Golden,
I told Senator Golden I'd ask him, I'm not sure if most of you know, that I started my career as a kinship caseworker. Yes.
You tell us all the time.
I know. So, I have a couple of questions, Mark, because it says here in the bill memo, it's a short bill, and I get what you're trying to do. It says that the director... to require the director to monitor kinship. Who is the director that we're asking to monitor kinship placement?
SOFA.
Why? But the child, Office of Children and Family Services does it now outside the City of New York, and the City of New York is ACS. When you do, when you respond to a complaint of abuse and neglect, and you make the determination that you have to remove that child, currently in the city, what about the rest of the other counties? But in the city, the first thing you're supposed to do is try and determine if there is a relative within the third degree of consanguinity to take that child. Generally, that's grandparents, unless the information is not available. And sometimes it's not. You don't always have cooperative parents. But we currently do this. So is it that we're not doing it in the other counties?
We're not doing it across the state. It's not a statewide law. It's a city. And it's not even a directive in the city. It's a policy.
It's been one for 20 years now.
But still, it's not legislated, it's a policy.
Okay, so if we would have legislated, then they would be required to first determine if there's a level of a relative within the third degree of consanguinity. And then after that, you already have the agency, either the Administration for Children's Services directly, while there's an active fact-finding case going on in an Article 10 neglect case, and then the foster care agency that monitors the kinship placement. So why would you want to duplicate it and have it done by SOFA as well?
Can I answer that? The answer is, as an attorney, this gives the grandparent relationship a certain power and existence and recognition under the law. Certain relationships require that.
And I understand that, Chris. I'm just saying I think if you place a child in a kinship home, You know, that's a decision that's made by the agency at the time of placement. That kinship foster parent could be a grandparent, aunt, uncle, anybody within the third degree of continuity.
Right.
Still has to be approved as a foster parent.
It does.
Pursuant to the state rule.
But someone
and then monitored the same way a not what they call a traditional foster parent is.
I understand it, but let's say that it goes to somebody has this would give someone legal standing to challenge that who happens to be a parental grandparent.
They already have that. They can go into court and request custody.
It gives them more power in effect. It would make a judge notice, and Senator Diaz thinks that anything that empowers grandparents is worth it.
I'm all for that. I just think I think they already have this power. I understand what he's trying to do. I'm going to vote with that rec only because I want to look at what's done in the other counties. Well, I support the concept. I think it's already done.
Okay.
And I just wonder what we would get out of having so much get involved in child welfare cases.
Any other comment?
Yeah, just for a minute, I think this is established by case law.
No, I understand that, Senator Reisenhofer. I'm just saying, my only concern is we're now going to add another agency into the life of a child who's in foster care already.
Another set of eyes.
That's a problem.
I think it's duplicative, and I don't really.
I understand your point.
Thank you.
I understand your point. All right, all in favor?
Aye.
Right. Okay.
2216, Senator Diaz, regarding the NORC, closes the gap between the financing that's available in the market today between public and private, and he's asking a yes vote on that. It's been through committees three times.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, one negative. All in favor, next bill?
2217 Diaz. Again, having to do with NORC. Eliminate the requirement that NORC housing be solely built for seniors under the Diaz scheme that certain apartment buildings or other dwellings could qualify as NORC if they meet the 45% requirement, even if they weren't built just for seniors. He's asking a yes for that.
Okay.
Excuse me, what is the cost?
I still don't know what it means. How
could there be a cost?
I don't have
because NORC's the way they're financed, it's a contribution by the participants rather than to the reserve.
That's correct. We've had that argument with finance by the Senate leadership.
Yeah, I mean there is no cost.
You're right.
Yeah, I disagree with you.
Okay. All right. Okay. Next one.
Yes, 2778, a bill by Senator Reisenhofer, which again is common sense, cap real property taxes for persons over 70 years of age and who have adjusted gross incomes of $70,000 or less. Senator Diaz supports this. It just, again, is common sense meaning reality. Yes, Senator.
Who's going to pay for that?
Yes,
you sent the bill.
That's a very good question.
They're hitting you.
Yeah. First of all, this is an opted by municipalities whether or not you want to extend to 77. What's happening right now, Senator Golden, in our area, is that a lot of people that are 70 and older are actually opting to leave the state. Okay, because of the differential in property taxes between this state and other states. So a municipality can do the analysis, they figure, well, let's try to keep our seniors here in their home paying taxes as opposed to going to Florida. We lose the tax. That's the motivation behind the legislation.
But would that cost money to come to the municipality?
Well, right now they're losing money because all the seniors many are leaving. If you can pay $10,000 in New York, you move to Florida, pay $2,000, you put $8,000 in your pocket.
So, but it would cost money?
No, it would save money.
So, what about the NORC?
You keep the whole NORC. What about the NORC? That legislation is flown by already.
I'm going to vote for this, Senator Reisenhofer, but I can't resist the urge to point out that he voted against the property tax cap bill that we passed 2 weeks ago. We should have done this.
Ooh,
we're all in rare.
All right.
This is what happens when you let us get away for a few days.
Last bill today is from Stuart Cousins, 4288, which is an act which really only has particular circumstances to the city of New York, and it would allow them to get correct city funds.
Don't go, please. Okay, let me vote for this and don't go. Let me face it.
I'm with that, Rick, on that last one.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. With that, Rick.
Okay. How many we have? All right. Let me talk to you about another issue. We are dealing with the budget. We are in negotiation. As you know, there was some money that was supposed to be the executive was proposing to cut from the senior citizen budget. And then there was another Title 20, which was threatening to close 102 or 110 senior citizen centers in the city, according to Mayor Bloomberg. So we are facing, I as a chairman of the committee, I'm open for suggesting, guys, we are fighting, really fighting. As of today, we're holding tight. The governor is asking for more cuts. As of last night, we were okay. But the governor keep asking for more cuts, and they asking us to go somewhere. I'm refusing to submit to cuts. I think that the aging population has suffered too much, and we don't need to be putting them to more suffering. If we achieve that the Title 20 be put back together, and also the COLA that was cut, the COLA, we might have a little chance to put the COLA back. If we do that, then we are in good shape, and you could go to your community and say that your community has done fantastic for senior citizens. So I don't know, as of today, we're okay. We form an advisory board. Give me the name of the advisory board in our board.
It's in the report.
Okay. So we'll give you some of the names, including the commissioner.
Michael Burgess, the director of the State Office for the Aging, Lillian Barrios Paoli, the DIPTA commissioner, Laura Cameron, the executive director of the New York State Association of Area Agencies on Aging, Bobby Sackman, whom all of you know, Justin Cunningham, Michael Adams, Nancy Miller from an organization called Visions, Anne-Marie Cook from Lifespan of Greater Rochester.
So we have our 21 members, and I coordinated a meeting last week with that committee, myself, with Senator Gillibrand, to start talking about the Older American Act that's coming to the federal government soon. So we are started moving on that. We have great advice from that committee. That committee came from all over the state. They flew from Rochester, from Long Island. They came to that meeting, and we have a great advisory board, and they do a fantastic job in advising me, advising the committee, and helping us put the agenda together, so to fight this Title 20. There is one technicality in the Older American Act that the. What was the thing on the senior center? There's no language there.
There's no language, no specific language in the Older Americans Act pertaining to senior centers. Yet a lot of the funding used by senior centers, in fact, funnels down from the Older Americans Act. One of the recommendations is to add specific language in the Older Americans Act for senior centers. And Senator Gillibrand's staff attorney will be working on some members of the advisory council to see how that can be done.
Okay, so for the next meeting, I will invite you guys, or anyone of you will attend, I would be glad to have you at the next meeting with the advisory board. There are people from all, they're not Democrat, they're not Republican, there are people that deal with senior citizens from all over the state. And they come, they meet with me and with us, and they are contributing a lot to the process of senior citizens. too. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.